people seem to want to see Lost Horizon. They seem to think they need it, and I do too. I believe we all need a chance to dream and to hope, and it's about time we did something good and wholesome on the screen, and I hope that Lost Horizon is that kind of picture.
1937's Lost Horizon is a classic film about escaping societal norms for a chance at actual freedom, and the free will to decide whether or not to become a slave to the tortures of life. It's about finding what really matters in life, heaven on earth, before inevitably losing it to modern-day idealism. Frank Capra's always deft hand was a warm take on James Hilton's book. Lost Horizon is also a clumsily made 1973 musical that was horribly mismanaged and is widely considered to be one of the worst movies ever made. Care to see a dub Peter Finch sing terribly all while hardly ever moving his mouth? This movie will make you mad as hell. And sitting at 2.5 hours, I can't believe I had to take so much of it. I swear this movie was written under duress, literally under the gun. No one could write these lyrics and actually think they were on the right track, could they? Did this movie inspire the Razzies? To quote the movie, your reflection reflects in everything you do, and everything you do reflects on you.
Was everybody high?
There's a lost horizon waiting to be found.
Well, Sean, we've landed in Shangri-La. Do you think we'll survive this episode? We're not going to do a bit, are we?
Friendly doors open wide. Come and share the peaceful life you will find inside.
We're gonna crash our plane in the Himalayas and then we're going to live in a matte painting.
My name.
My name is Chang.
My name is Chang.
That sounds racist.
It is.
Oh. My name is Chang.
This movie is a real clunker.
Pulling together, working together. Just living together.
No, but seriously, it's a movie about a disaster, and then it turns into a musical, but then the entire thing is a disaster.
I would say that James Hilton is likely spinning in his grave so fast that it's turned into a lathe.
Different people look at life from different points of view. If you really want the things I have.
This is like the remake of Willy Wonka. It's overblown, it's unnecessary. It's a costume drama masquerading as a classic in the making. But it's so fucking forced, and yet it's barely trying.
Can there be too much sunshine?
I hate this bit. This is a stupid bit.
Different people look at
Frank Capra, he barely needed anything, you know? It was simple for him. But this one, with a swell arm, ultra nose, and bolo. Fuck me, dude.
What are you doing?
I'm cold.
We'll be back with the show in just a second.
Oh, okay, so... Yeah, in the original, in the 1937, it's got this opening, which is great because it's so damn racist. They're like, we've got to save the white people from the natives who are going to tear them apart. And anyway, the second version is written by Larry Kramer.
Yes.
And Larry Kramer is super famous for starting GMHC, Gay Men's Health Crisis,
yeah.
And ACT UP in the 80s. And he was a very early victim or person who got HIV and was expected to die, but didn't die until 2020. And he was a writer. But at the time, he was rewriting scripts for Columbia.
Yeah.
And so he wrote the screenplay for this. But it's almost
word for word,
scene for scene.
Hello, it's Conway here. Where are those plans you promised us?
It is like scene by scene.
It's scene for scene. It's hilarious. He did nothing to earn the money, basically, that he earned in this, which he lived on for 25 years.
Yeah, yeah. He was set up. How was that even possible?
He made money, and his brother-in-law apparently invested it for him.
It wasn't making royalties off of this.
I don't think anybody made royalties off of this.
Yeah, I mean, seriously, I'm pretty sure that this movie inspired Peter Finch to win that Oscar for Network, right? Because he was mad as hell.
I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore!
But yeah, no, everybody is suckered into this. Peter Finch,
yes.
Michael York, Olivia Hussey, yes. Sally Kellerman, George Kennedy, James Shigeta, John Gielgud, and Charles Boyer. Just from the get-go, I just have to say that the reason that I love the 1973 version of Lost Horizons is because it literally has every great mind of Hollywood in 1973. It's got Burt Bacharach on music. It's got Hal David.
Well, they almost
lyrics.
Had Julie Andrews at one point.
Well, they had all those stars that I mentioned. It's directed by Charles Girott, who had just directed Anne of a Thousand Days, and that is a fucking amazing movie. And Ross Hunter is the one who should have been put out to pasture.
And now here's the man who is probably more uptight than anybody tonight, because Ross Hunter is the producer of Lost Horizon. And I suppose you have more of the worries than anybody, don't you, Ross?
I have more of the worries, but it's so exciting, and I'm really so thrilled. I can't believe that our picture was selected. It's just that marvelous.
Yes, and may I ask you, was it your own brainchild to make Lost Horizon into a musical?
Yes, it was. I've wanted to do this for 10 years, and finally got the opportunity about 2 years ago to start it.
Come on, time to take you out to pasture, buddy.
He should. Well,
time to put you down. You got yourself a broken leg.
He should have been put down. He did all these great things in the 50s, but then in like 1967, he produces what? Valley of the Dolls, which was this ginormous flop that they thought it was going to be. And why was it a flop? It was a flop because he was from another time, and making movies had changed. He had not changed. And this movie is another example of him trying to... Oh, Liv Ulmann. Oh my God, I forgot. Liv Ulmann is...
Liv Ulmann.
Remember. Second billing in this. She came to America. She became this huge star, and she really can... not speak English all that well. She does, you know, she has just a thick accent. So it's hilarious because they have her dubbed.
Is she the teacher then?
She is the teacher, the one who goes like her.
Oh my God. I love the part where they pick up the boy and he goes,
yes. It's funny. It's coming up. Like literally everybody in Hollywood got together and made the biggest, most terrible, steaming pile of shit movie that had ever been made.
Could anything have saved it? Like, just say, let's say, cutting an hour out of the movie.
Well, you know, yes. I do think that the story itself...
Well, the story's great.
Is great, yes. I do think that the movie could have done much better if it had a different producer, if Charles Girott had... I think he was really hamstrung. You know, I don't think they let him go.
The director? They didn't let him, like, do anything?
I don't think they did. Because, I mean, look, the movie is exactly the same as the 1937
True
version.
True that.
He could be a maniac. He may be a maniac, for all we know.
Peter Finch's character
What's his name again? It starts with a C.
It's so weird. I don't know characters' names. I only know them by their actors'
names. That's hilarious, yeah.
Conway.
Anyway, he is, like, this... great peacekeeper guy.
Right. Well, that's his job. He's basically been sent off to be a sort of a diplomat for people, like a peacekeeping diplomat.
Yes.
And a lot of people in the book anyway, they talk about how he's like great mind, great person to see.
Yes.
Thrown into jobs that for some reason he just does, but he's so much better than them, but you can trust the man, you know?
You can trust him. And he has a thing that he wrote at some time in the past where he says, every man has a moment where he can glimpse eternity.
There are moments in every man's life when he glimpses the eternal.
And it's that line which the High Lama gets, he finds this paper somehow in Shangri-La, and he decides that that's the person he must have to take over when the High Lama dies. And so that's why they kidnap him. And everybody else is just sort of collateral damage.
You don't need my Shangri-La.
That is not how the song goes.
That's how it feels inside my body.
How it goes.
But like,
all of the songs are all terrible.
Yes.
Like every single song. But some of them are, they just reach a pinnacle of awfulness that, that almost yeah,
they're,
no
they're
songs ever.
They're actually fun to walk around and sing to yourself.
They are. Why? Like the one, like the Festival of the Family. That's just got. That's just one of the, my favorite songs forever.
Start with a man, and you have one. Woman, and then you have two.
And it just goes on from there. And then Bobby Van jumps in, you know, just at the right moment to give it a little bit more.
Tap 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 tap, and he falls in the water, and he's like,
"Yeah!" He's like,
he's like Jack Nicholson playing the Joker.
So funny. And the songs are, and the lyrics are. 1492. What's the year that Babe Ruth hit his 60th home run? What? Wellington at Waterloo, who became the hero at the Battle of Bull Run. Learning can be lots of fun. Question me and answer.
Oh, God. Oh, fuck.
Jesus.
Those are real lyrics.
So great.
Questioning me and answer. Oh, fucking God.
I love all that shit.
Oh, fuck me. That's awful.
It's so funny. Oh, and this is Charles Boyer. And Charles Boyer is the High Lama.
High Lamas or Low Lamas?
Will you, a High Lama, answer our questions?
Yes.
And Charles Boyer is supposed to have started. He fell into Shangri-La.
This valley celebrates the natural life.
And so here he is, 250 years later, and he's still alive, but he's about to die. That's why he gets.
Yeah,
that's why
the,
he gets.
The candle is symbolic of his life.
Yeah, it's going down.
Yes.
Oh, that's very good, Montetre. You are such an artiste. I didn't. You know.
I'm artistic.
It's very. It's so.
I'm such a little. I'm on the spectrum.
You are on the spectrum.
I'm on that artistic
spectrum.
Yeah,
that artistic spectrum. You're right there toward the. You know, weird end. But you know.
Oh God, man! Oh, that is a. We gotta be careful.
And now the High Lama's dead.
We found so some more torches.
They got some more torches. That was homophobic, right there.
No, no, I was doing Asian.
That was not okay. That was racist.
No. Let me take it back. It was a gay thing.
There's no place for you either. You're needed in the outside world, where the problems are far more urgent and pressing than they are here in Shangri-La.
he's all upset, and he's gonna take Olivia Hussey with him.
He's gonna take her because she's only 20, or
because
however.
She's only 20, but she came there in 1880.
Richika, her face! Look at her face! Her face! Look at her face!
So the reason that this is happening is because they've taken Olivia Hussey out of Shangri-La. And when they take her out of Shangri-La, they've already been told that she's going to quickly come back to her actual age.
Right, right, right.
Maria, what's she got to do with it?
She's coming with me.
George, you're crazy.
You can't take her away.
Why not? Because you can't.
Don't you know what will happen to her if she leaves Shangri-La?
I'm just a goofball.
He's goofy. They should make Lost Horizon, but with all Disney characters.
That would be great. And Peter Finch would be goofy.
Yeah. And Minnie Mouse and Mickey Mouse would be there like, we gotta get out of here.
That's right.
I'm taking her with me. Minnie's mine. We're going. Oh, God, look at her face. Oh, God. Look at her face.
Oh, there's Michael Rourke.
You big dummy. Yeah.
You big dummy.
Dummy.
Ah!
Dummy. 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 You big dummy.
And now everybody's dead, and here I am in the snow. Jesus.
How are you, Mr. Conway?
He has amnesia in both. But then
he regains and goes off his way.
He jumps out the window just in the nick of time and escapes back up into the snow.
And the book, he was on a ship with somebody and he's like, he didn't
really?
He didn't jump off, did he? He was like,
yeah. He's on
a
ship?
Yeah, he was like traveling. Like, it's actually it's quite amazing how much they... You have to know your geography pretty well because they get him
very far away from Shangri-La.
Yeah, he's quite far, and then he jumps ship.
Since that night that he jumped off the ship till 2 weeks ago, I've been missing him by inches.
You don't mean it. Was he as determined as that to get back?
And the friend he's telling it to, he didn't. He goes, oh no, he's much too high cut.
Do you think he's gone back to Shangri-La?
Yeah, he's not a coward like that. No, he meant like they thought, like, did he commit suicide off the bridge? He's like, no, he wasn't that kind of a man.
Yes,
some call. It was much nicer than.
It's Hughes. That is the coward's way out.
Don't preach that cheap secondhand stuff to me.
We have said shit about Capra. All we've done is
Capra did a good job. Charles Girard. Not so much. Charles Girard, not so much.
Could you at least try with his name?
No, fuck that. The guy who directed.
He didn't try for the movie.
No, I'm not sure what happened with this movie. It's just such a fucking train wreck of multiple trains all hitting each other head on. And it's just, it makes me so happy.
Trouble with you is you haven't got any inner resources.
You can try really hard and, like that song says, I went so far and tried so hard, but in the end, it doesn't really matter.
R.I.P. Chester.
Yeah, P. Chester. Is that who that
is? Some dude named Chester was, I think, one of the lead singers of that band.
Oh, really?
You know, I used to win tickets on the radio a lot as a kid. And one time I won tickets to Linkin Park, to a pair of tickets. My brother loved the band, so I won tickets for the radio show. And then we got an internet drawing. And this is like outside of my luck jurisdiction, but we won an extra 9 tickets.
Nice!
Like, to bring 9 extra friends.
Wow.
So we were able to get a couple of different, and I was young. But we had to go backstage to the band and everything. Oh, yeah, I had friends, but I let my brother bring friends. And I brought a couple of friends. We also brought in a couple of chauffeurs, like older, because we were still under 18.
Yeah, oh.
It was kind of fun.
Was it fun? Yeah.
Only one of the members was kind of a dick. Like, he was offended that somebody had, he didn't have anything to sign. All he had was this pizza box that we had gotten from backstage. And
that's fair enough.
He didn't have everybody sign it. And one guy was like, you're going to make me sign a pizza box? And I was like, dude.
Just shut up.
Shut up. Like, because in the end, it doesn't even matter.
Yeah, because in the end, it doesn't even matter. But that was a really good ending to that story.
Thank you. I had to tie it around with how you opened, so.
So
but fuck, I didn't like the band, brilliant. but my brother had a good time, which was nice.
Was that the same band?
Linkin Park, yeah.
That was the same band that sang that song that I was just quoting a minute ago?
Pretty fucking sure.
Really?
Yeah.
And they were around when singing that song when you were a kid?
I was maybe 16 or 17.
Wow. Is that so? I had no idea that song was that old.
Years ago.
Really? Yeah. Oh, okay. Anyway, the 37 version is
Columbia.
Over
now. Look a little racist at the end.
Yeah,
there.
They definitely have their little Chinese.
Yeah, how do you call that? The racist, like, Chinese font?
Chinese, their characters.
This Shangri-La.
Do you believe it?
Yes. Yes, I believe it. I believe it
because I want to believe it.
But how he survives in the Himalayas, nobody knows. But there
No. Did you not see? He like at least had one jacket.
Yeah, he's got a jacket. Yeah,
and he's got his brother's staff.
Yeah, he's
infection.
Yeah, that's staff infection. Yes, he has that. And now he's back, and now he can go on with his relationship with Liv Ulmann and own Shangri-La.
And would I go back if I knew? I come to you with all my dreams and I bring you love.
Which is great because what is Shangri-La going to do without a white guy running it? But I love it. Thank you for watching it. Thank you for indulging it. I know it's a terrible movie. It's just one of my favorites.
It is one of the most god-awful pieces of shit.
It is a god-awful piece of shit. And it's a musical. Fucking love it. And it's a musical. With Burt Bacharach and Hal David. It's everything. So, anyway, what are we going to watch next, Tom?
I don't know yet, but we should at least rate this one, I guess, first. These two.
It's very difficult.
No. You have to rate it on the enjoyment factor.
Oh, well, my enjoyment factor is like 12 out of 3 claps. It's over the top.
Can I see that?
Yeah. 1.
That was 9.
I don't know.
That was That's 9. All. That was 9.
Yeah. It's all of them. All of the claps.
Yeah, you gave about 14 there.
Yeah. All of the claps. I love it. I don't love the original. Claps, the original is a good movie. It's solid, but it's just, yeah, it's no, there's no point in watching it.
I'm not going to rate that one then.
You do.
Montetre. Even if I gave it a 0, it wouldn't affect your 19 score out of 3.
Yeah.
And I'll just go ahead and just give I'll give 2 out of 3 for the original.
Okay.
And I'll give a big fat goosing to their musical.
A goose for the musical. Well, that it totally deserves it. It is a terrible movie. Only watch it if that kind of thing entertains you. It entertains me greatly.
So yeah, next time, I don't know, we were talking about all sorts of stuff, but I'm thinking what we should do is we should do The Room.
We should do The Room?
Yeah.
Surprise!
Directed by and written by.
And starring.
Tommy Wiseau.
Yeah. And The Room is a very well-known turkey of a movie.
Talk about a goosing.
Yeah. So that is, that sounds like a lot of fun to me. I have never seen The Room. I've always wanted to hear, you know everything about The Room. And we'll get into that and the reasons why.
I'm going to have to read the book.
Yeah, exactly. Read the book because this is definitely a podcast about books. So read the book.
No, well, no, that's all. I'd yet to ever read Greg Sestero's book. Which is what they called the movie that they made about it. It was called The Disaster Artist. So I need.
That's a great movie. I've seen that movie.
So I want to read that book because I'm pretty sure that's some pretty good delving into it. Or however. Yeah. Anyway.
Yeah. Definitely.
I think you're gonna really hate your life.
Okay. Well, you know,
I
question my, you know, the choices that I've made frequently. So.
I mean, it is.
This will be one more.
It's easier to get through actually than Lost Horizon, but. The Room is a worse movie. It is.
It's even worse than Lost Horizon. That sounds great.
But The Room is then also easier to get through. I think it's because it's shorter.
So The Room it is.
Hey, be on the lookout for spoons.
Look out.
We're going to do questions. from
Questions from... and answers from the audience.
Question me an answer. Answer with a question.
Yes, that's right.
How do you feel the film represents this utopian idea?
I think it represents it very poorly, personally.
Why?
Because it's racist from top to bottom, and it's a hierarchical, and it's a religious, structure, and I just don't find it to be utopia.
Hello.
My question essentially is, would you guys stay there if you were in these character shoes?
Were they singing the whole time?
I'm going to go with yes.
I would definitely, that would not be a deal breaker for me.
You don't have to partake, but it is happening in the background.
I can head for the hills.
Yeah.
They're cold up there.
I can stuff flowers in my ears.
Yeah. No, that is not a deal breaker for me. The music is definitely not a deal breaker for me. I kind of love it. But if I was going to stay there, there would be a revolution. we've got an eternity. So why only one palace? You know, there are hundreds of people living in the Valley of the Blue Moon, as they call it. And those are all the people who supply everything for the palace. Why only a palace? Why can't everybody live in a super nice house?
You'd be the revolutionary llama.
If the llama died and you guys just showed up, would you stay and be their llama?
I would stay and dismantle the llama system.
Oh.
That's what I mean. I would dismantle that whole hierarchical system.
Anarchy, like cannibalism.
Yes. I would definitely go for cannibalism because that is really the only true love.
Blah, 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 blah.
Oh, he's broken. broken again. Yeah, I love the idea of Shangri-La, but I don't think it has to be the system where there's one leader, you know, and then administrators and then peasants. That doesn't sound like Shangri-La to me. That sounds like a serfdom where everybody lives forever, lucky for the king.
I'm glad that we don't live in a serfdom.
We kind of do. We're all, you know, I mean, well, you don't have to go to work, but I do.
You don't have to work. What are you worried about?
Bye.
Bye.
He's going, my child.
Going.
But he will return.
Still go with him if you want to.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye, Bob.
We can do the outro.
Is there an outro?
Almost any time now.
Any moment.
This Shangri-La, do you believe it?
Wait, is that for real? Oh, I'm sorry.
Michael York. Hello, Austin.
I suggest you don't worry about this sort of thing and just enjoy yourself. That goes for you all, too.
This Shangri-La, do you believe it?
Yes! I believe it! Because I want to believe it. Doesn't the story mean anything to you?
What could it mean to me?
Oh, you're right, Montetré. Shangri-La is no place for you.
And you should realize that it's no place for you either. You're needed in the outside world, but things are far more urgent and pressing than they are here in Shangri-La.
I know. But I've found peace. And I've found love. And I intend to hold on to my peace and my love. Look at me, Montetré. Is this the skin of an old man? Are these the goggles of an old man? Is this the heart, the feelings of an old man?
Sean.
Yes?
I beg you to think again and change your mind.
Sean ponders.
I have to get out of here.
Then I will come with you.
Look at his face! Look at his face!